Get started. We got a lot of ground to cover this morning. Good morning. For those that don't know me, my name is Harry Overk. I'm the mayor of Prescott. Thank you for coming out today. I know everybody is keen on this topic. There's a lot of information that we're going to be putting out. The briefings that you're going to get today are going to be on the city website. So if you want to take a little more time to look at them, study them, then go there and you'll see them. The first hour, I think, we'll complete the three briefings and leave the last hour for question and answer. I'd like to introduce the other speakers today. We have Lynn Gilroy from the Reason Foundation, and Michael Lamar, our Prescott City Manager. Those with questions, just step up to the mic at the podium here. Please ask your question and refrain from making statements. Long statements, so we can get as many questions answered as possible. We will give each questioner 1 minute to phrase and answer your question. And I have a timer out there that'll raise his hand, and I'll let you know when you're exceeding your minute. I think it's important for our police and fire personnel to know that as a city, we want there to be a pension for them to enjoy when they're ready to retire. The issue is not, is with the pension system. As the system stands today, it will be harder and harder for the fund to remain solvent and provide a pension long-term without some additional reform. My briefing will provide some history on the PSPRS and how we got to where we are today. And I think the first slide that you see up there shows how our city council feels are working to solve Prescott's PSPRS unfunded liability. Talk a little bit about what PSPRS is. Not everyone in the audience may be familiar with it, so I want to lay it out here with a definition. As you can see, the public safety retirement system was created by the legislature. I've had many people say to me that the city determines the retirement benefits for our public safety personnel, but that is incorrect. And if you look up here, you'll see that the state wanted to provide a uniform, consistent, statewide, equitable retirement program. You couldn't do that if every city was doing their own thing and setting up their own benefits. So the only way that this could be set up was to be set up by the legislature and by the state. The city only determines our personnel, public safety personnel, annual salary and their assignment. The state determines all retirement benefits. Let's talk a little bit about the history of the PSPRS system. In 1968, the legislature established the PSPRS system and required all entities with public safety personnel to participate. Because the pensions were so well funded, Prop 100 was brought forward by the legislature, was designed to prevent the legislature from sweeping funds from the state pension systems to fund other fiscal programs. But in effect, it had a constitutional amendment, which stated pensions could not be diminished or impaired. This resulted in pensions being protected above normal contract law. In 2001, the legislature instituted the Deferred Retirement Option Program, called DROP. The DROP allows employees to accumulate monthly retirement contributions in a separate account, not the PSPRS fund, and withdraw that as a large lump sum upon retirement. This DROP program has caused considerable increases to our unfunded liability. In addition, the PSPRS fund suffered significant losses during the market downturn in 2001 due to the dot-com bubble. 7 years later, the fund again suffered additional losses due to the second market downturn in 2007-20 and 2007-2008 based on the housing bubble. Both of these events increased the city's unfunded liability. In 2011, the legislature saw the growing statewide unfunded liability and initiated some reforms. The reforms increased the employee contribution and reduced the pension benefit increase for retirees. I use the term COLA because it is similar in nature and more understandable than using the term pension benefit increase. During During the period from 2014 through 2016, members in the PSPRS sued to overturn the reforms of 2011. And due to the 1998 constitutional pension clause, they won their cases and the result was added to our unfunded liability. Also in 2016, Senate Bill 1428 and Proposition 124, which you voted on last year, were approved by the voters. Lynn Gilmore from the Reason Foundation will address these in detail in his presentation this morning. So what are some of the problems that we see with the current PSPRS system? One of the things, of course, is we're seeing difficulties, financial difficulties, with the fact that it's a defined benefit system rather than a defined contribution system. And most of the private industry is converted to the defined contribution retirement system because defined benefit systems are so unaffordable. Basically, through the largest of the legislature, the state granted more benefits than cities and fire districts can afford to pay. All investment fund losses are paid by the taxpayer. Any change reducing benefits can be overturned by the courts due to the constitutional pension clause that was established in 1998. All COLAs are compounded, adding significantly to the unfunded liability each year. Because PSPRS is a defined benefit system, the taxpayer contributes a lion's share of the system's contributions. This chart shows the funding ratio against its liability. As you can see, in 2003, the fund was 100% funded. And by the close of 2015, it had dropped to 48%. What this means is that the state has less than one half the money we need to pay out the benefits that are owed to our public service personnel. In 2016, the unfunded liability increased another $1.1 billion statewide for a total unfunded liability of 7.7. So you'll see up here that we're still showing the 2015 results. In 2016, at the end of 2016, this had moved up to 7.7, and this is at 47.3 right now. Since 2001, the PSPRS funds return on investments have been consistently below their assumed rate of return, resulting in an increase in unfunded liability. So you can see right here that the gray line is the market. See that there were significant downturns in 2001, 2002, again in 2008, 2009, and of course this did add to our unfunded liability. But you can also see here, since 93 up to the present time, actually 2015, that this was the PSPRS board's expected return on their investment. And back here in about 93, it looks like they were probably about 8.5, almost 9%. And in 2015, they were 7.65. But you can see starting in 2000, 2001, they started to go below what they thought they were going to make in investment. And they have consistently stayed at around the 5% level when they were actually saying they were going to make, you know, 8% or 7.5 or something. So this delta in here adds to our unfunded liability and has increased it. I kind of apologize for this chart. It's kind of a busy one, but I think it's, it has some very important information on it. I think the first thing to look at is our funded ratio for the PSPRS from Prescott. This is Prescott's information. And you can see that back in 2000, 2001, we were fully funded. And then starting in 2002, with the dot-com bubble downturn, the fund started to lose money, and it's continued on down to the present time, and we're at 31% funded. You can also look at, you know, about 2001 is when the drop program started, and it started to kick in right around 2005, 2006. And you can see that caused a significant reduction also that has continued to the present time. I've had many people say to me, well, you know, Prescott's not paying his PSPRS liability. And that's incorrect, because I can show you right here that during this 17-year period, we paid in $45,500,000 in support of our contribution to the program. Today, if you look over here, this is what we have in the trust fund right now. We have $35 million. And you can see from 2000 up to now, this period of time, we've only increased our funded status by $6,500,000. That means almost $39 million has gone to pay benefits in the system. So if you have a funded ratio of 31%, how should we look at that? And if you take a look here at this chart, you'll see that according to the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation, a funding ratio of 65% is considered critical. Of the 230 Arizona entities that are currently in the PSPRS system, 174 are funded at less than 80%. And you can see up there that 80% is considered to be in danger. Of those 174, 112 are funded at 60% or below. So you can see this is a critical statewide problem. I think the important thing to take from this chart is that you can see starting in about 2000, you know, we were starting to increase our trust assets. And starting in 2000, it flatlined and it's barely climbed at all. It's only climbed $6 million in basically 17 years. I think the thing you need to look at, this is the promised benefits by the legislature. So you can see that there's a tremendous delta here, and that's the major problem with the whole system right now. I'd like to go ahead and make a quick comparison with the Dow Jones, but you could actually make those with the other indices that are out there too. And as you can see, this is our funded ratio, and we were doing pretty good, like I said, up to about 2000. And then started in 2000, it started to come down. And you can see here that they had a loss here in the market, and they had a loss here in the Dow. And you would expect at some point that, you know, this line would start to go up and then unison or in concert with the rise in the market. But that has not occurred. And it continues to go down, and that's the reason why we're at 31% today. I think this is a very interesting chart for a number of reasons. What I'm going to do is show you the impact in 1 year from 2017 to 2018. And in 2017, you can see for fire that we were paying 72% of their salary into the PSPRS each year. As we go into 2018, that's going to jump to 85%. So we'll be paying 85% of their salary into the PSPRS. For fire, it was 77% in 17. It's going to jump to almost 92%. It's almost their entire pay is again going to go into the retirement system. And what this has done, this has added quite a bit of debt to us. So we were going to pay, I think, right around $6.4 million in 2018. But with these increased requirements because of the recent legislation, or part of it is due to legislation, we're seeing that we're going to have an additional $1.25 million that we're going to have to put into the PSPRS to pay off the liability in 2018. So we're going to be paying about $7.5 million. And that is about 23% of our general fund that we have. We have $33 million in the general fund, and 7.5 is about 23%. So we're almost 0.25% just going to pay the PSPRS unfunded liability. That doesn't count any of the other, you know, the pay for the police, the pay for the fire, the pay for other government employees, parks, recreation, and everything else that comes out of the general fund. So obviously, you know, we're starting to get to a crunch point, and that's one of the things that we're going to have to work very closely on. The thing I want to show you on this is, as you can see right here, this is 2018. We said that's going to be $7.5 million. And as you can see, it's going to continue to go up. We're going to have a greater cost to retire unfunded liability as we move forward. Now, this is over the very even graduation, but I don't think it's going to be that way, because when you deal with actuarials and the fact that there could be some losses in the program, things of that nature, this is going to be more of a jagged line rather than the straight progression. People might be wondering what this red line means. Basically, when I said that in the past, we paid exactly what the PSPRS told us to pay, and that proves it. This is what we were told to pay, and we paid exactly what we're supposed to pay. And actually, right now, we're above paying what we owe. And you might want to know why that's occurring, and that's occurring because of the 19 hotshots. We have, I think, about 10 people that were put into the PSPRS that are receiving benefits, and the state has given us some additional funding to support that. It's not all the funding we need to support them, but it's some funding right now, and that's the reason why we see a little bit more of a contribution than normal. One of the problems, I can see up there, Jeopardy is misspelled. I apologize. I think one of the things that we have to be very concerned about is that you know, the legislature on occasion decides that they want to support certain special interests. And there's at least one bill in right now in the legislature where they want to go ahead and have construction sales tax at the point of sale, not at being a part of the sale of the home. And so in doing so, we could see if that passes, we could lose about $1.138 million out of our general fund. We can't afford to lose that. So what I'm trying to show here is that we've got at least two programs right now that are funding sources for the general fund, construction rental sales tax and the rental sales tax, that provide a fair amount of funding for us. And we can't afford to lose that, because if we do, we're going to be in much more serious trouble. You know, I have a lot of people saying, well, what are you doing at the city level to try and help reduce some of this liability, and is there any way that you can find funding anywhere? Well, you see from this chart here that we've done that. We've reduced, since 2008, some of our staffing at the city. I think we're at about 80 people right now, and that money has been used to help pay down our PSPRS obligation. Actions on the way, other actions on the way. I see this as being twofold: what we can do with the legislature, and then secondly, what we can do locally. So we'll talk about the legislature first. I was just down at the legislature on Thursday. I spoke to the House Government Affairs Committee about the PSPRS system here in Prescott. And I can tell you that you know, it's on their radar. They're looking at a number of things down there. Nothing is really bubbled up to where I can tell you that something definitely is going on, but I do know that they are taking a look at trying to start some discussion, probably is about the best I can say right now, to support us on coming up with a solution for the PSPRS system. I'm also sending out about 30 or 40 letters to various mayors that are in the 50% category or below like us, and asking them if they are willing to come together and help me to talk to the legislature and try and get some kind of resolution started in the legislature to resolve the unfunded liability for the state. If we can do it for the state, it's gonna be good for all of us. One of the things I think we're gonna be looking at is trying to convince the speaker this year to have an ad hoc committee started where they can bring in experts and get a much better understanding of exactly the problems with the PSPRS. And lastly, we continue to work with the Arizona League of Cities and Towns. They represent 91 municipalities. They have been very supportive in the past of taking issues that we have at the cities and towns to the legislature and trying to get the legislature to have proactive support for some of the issues that we have. So we'll continue to work with them. So let's just talk a little bit about what we're doing here in Prescott. The city council has been working for a number of months to review various options, suggestions by the staff, the public, and ideas we've received from other states and how they fund their pension program. Of an original 14 options, 6 remain at present. These include continuing to reduce spending, looking at using some of the reserves from our general fund, borrowing from internal or external funding sources, sale of excess city property, and a dedicated sales tax for public safety operations and unfunded liability. I will say that these are not the only option. We continue to look at other options as become available. I think we're also looking at considering a citizen survey to determine the most likely option that the voters would support in reducing the liability and maintaining adequate public service operations. Under citizens' actions, basically what we're looking at there is related to our citizens and voters having continued dialogue with our state representatives and the state leadership to communicate preferred legislative actions on issues that are going to be facing us. We will continue to assess input from the Goldwater Institute, the Reason Foundation, and other think tanks, which may provide critical expertise on various aspects of the PSPRS. We're going to look at public-private competition studies to gain increased effectiveness and efficiency in providing city public services. And we're going to analyze critical city services, determine if these services can be provided differently. This will be covered in more detail by the city manager. In closing, Prescott's severe unfunded liability is not of our making. As you heard this morning, it is a statewide problem requiring statewide solution. Whatever Prescott does to address this problem, it will only be a beginning and not a stopgap measure. I believe prior to Prescott's commitment to a long-term payoff plan, there must be a corresponding commitment at the state level for a permanent solution to the pension liability issue. State-level action on the unfunded liability problem will not happen without strong public demand from you, from everyone sitting here in this room today. I would appreciate and sincerely ask for your support in this endeavor with your calls, letters, and emails to our governor, legislators, and especially the leadership of the Capitol requesting their action on these issues. I think if you do want to write letters or you do want to call and you can't find the information, make sure you do call down to the city. We have all that information and we can provide that for you. If you also need some help in trying to figure out how to word a letter or something like that, we can help you with that also. I want to thank you for giving me this opportunity to inform you on the PSPRS program. I'll be followed by Leonard Gilroy of the Reason Foundation.
Foundation. We're a national think tank, and bear with me for a while. I get this set up here. And my organization, I'm happy to be based in the Phoenix area, so I'm here in this state. But we're a national organization, and one of the projects that I lead at my organization is what we call our Pension Integrity Project. And essentially, the problems and challenges that you just heard about that you're dealing with right now here in Prescott are not uncommon challenges out there across the country these days. The same dynamics you saw in these charts that the mayor just showed you, I produced some of those charts. We produced some of those charts for many pension systems around the country. There are many that look just like that. I know that isn't necessary consolation, but you know what's happened here over the last two decades really is a dramatic shift in how public pension systems have been funded, operated, and really some of the assumptions underlying them have really been called into question as you look at sort of the external market dynamics. So I'm gonna walk you through a little bit of that to explain the problem, okay? And how did you get here? What is the situation? And then I'll spend a little time talking about also the reform effort last year. And the way I would sort of liken that, I'll cut to the chase a little bit on that because my organization, we served as sort of pro bono consultants, if you will, to our Senate President, Senator Debbie Lesko, some folks on the House side, including Representative Campbell, I saw around here somewhere today. We're involved in a discussion with the Police and Fire Association statewide, because there was a shared understanding that there's a massive problem going on here, and that it needed a solution. And unfortunately, as we've learned in my organization and about over a decade of experience dealing with, you know, sort of troubleshooting these pension problems, the solutions aren't easy. The solutions sometimes take many steps over many years to try to address the problem. And I think one way I like to use analogies. I think it helps to, you know, kind of translate the arcane world of public pension systems to something people can relate to. Think of the current PSPRS situation. Frankly, I would apply it to every single pension system in the state right now. But we're here to talk about PSPRS. I'll just say there are others out there that you're exposed to as well. But you have to think of it like a chemical spill. What's been going on right now is you've got a chemical spill. It's been leaking this toxic chemical. I mean, that's the unfunded liability that's been growing and growing. And the first thing you do when you run into a chemical spill situation is you have to cap the spill, right? You've got to cap it. You've got to stop this problem from continuing. And then you have to go about the long slog of trying to clean up what has spilled already. And that is a long and difficult task. But I think it's an apt analogy for this type of situation. So I don't want to bore you with too much mechanics, but I find that getting people grounded on what are the costs of pension system, what are unfunded liabilities, that sort of thing, is a helpful grounding piece of education, so to speak. So I just want to explain here, there's two pieces of a public pension system in the cost that you're paying today. Unfortunately, if the assumptions and everything that was sort of baked into the to your pension costs were accurate, you'd only be paying one side of this. You'd be paying the side called defined benefit normal cost. Pensions are not like Social Security. That would be a Ponzi scheme. And as far as my knowledge, those are illegal. Public pension systems are designed to be pre-funded. You can close a pension system tomorrow. You don't need new people coming into it. I mean, they're meant to be pre-funded. If your assumptions are right, that should work. And what they do is they basically say, we will estimate, we look at our employee base, and we estimate what would it take today, assuming we get, you know, X percent returns on average in the market over the next several decades, because you make an investment in an employee today, a new hire, you're basically on the hook for that employee for the next 4 to 5 to 6 decades, as far as pension goes, because they're going to work for a set amount of time, then they will retire and start to collect a benefit, and there will probably be some sort of spousal or dependent benefit that goes on beyond that. So the actuaries have to figure out, well, what's that dollar amount you've got to put in today to prepay this year's benefit for somebody that's going to draw that benefit 2-3 decades out? You have to make a lot of assumptions. You have to make assumptions, what are you going to get on the market? When's this person going to die? When is their spouse going to die? I mean, these are very morbid sorts of things, as you can imagine. But this is what actuaries think about. Because they have to estimate how long is that going to pay out going to have to last, and then I have to back my way into the numbers and discount it, because that's a way out number. So anyway, if all your assumptions though were right, then all you'd be paying today would be that normal cost. And if you look at Mayor Hobart's charts, those were the smaller dollar item in terms of your total pension contribution. And those costs are basically split between employees and the employer. The employee contribution rate, all police and fire in this state have a fixed contribution rate under statute. It's written in the law. And so the employer picks up the rest. So that is that half of the equation. But then what happens if your assumptions are wrong? And that's what you've been seeing for well over a decade now. If your assumptions are wrong, then you start to accumulate debt. That means you've made promises out there, but you haven't set enough money aside. That's what the unfunded liabilities are. Think of it as your commitments, your promises to workers, are your total liabilities, the funds you have put away for that. You know, when you subtract those two, what's left are unfunded liabilities. And so you have to pay that off. And what essentially the way that the pension systems work is you sort of pay it off kind of akin to a mortgage. You spread that out over some period, maybe 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 years. We've even seen some disaster scenarios where they spread it out even longer. And so you start paying down that debt slowly. But every year you accumulate debt, it just starts to pile up. And so what's happening is that even though your normal cost, your cost of providing today's benefit has been pretty stable, the cost of those unfunded liabilities, because your assumptions have not only been wrong, they've been wildly inaccurate. Not yours, I mean in the pension system, have been wildly inaccurate. And they've been starting to accredit, I mean, they've been starting to come back down to reality. But a fundamental problem, the mayor showed a great chart a second ago. It had the Dow Jones going skyrocketing. Any of you who look at the markets know that, you know, in the recent months, we've hit peaks, you know, in the market. We hit Dow 20,000, not that long ago. Back in the recession, that was a pipe dream. I mean, that wasn't that long ago. But then why, if we're investing in that market, why are we seeing our funded ratio go down? Why are we not seeing the benefit of this? It's not about the stock market. What has happened out there, just as a fundamental dynamic, is back in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, any of you who bought a house back then will remember that mortgage rates were not down in the 3 to 4% range like they are now. They were much higher, right? Because we had a higher interest rate environment globally. What has happened over, really, you know, since the turn of the century, has been a plummeting of global interest rates down to what you would call an ultra-low environment, even negative interest rates in some parts of the world. I have a hard time still getting my head around that. But if you are basing your assumptions of getting a 7 to 8% return and you are seeing a big chunk of what your investment portfolio would have in it plummeting, that means you can have sky-high stock markets, but what it means is you have to actually take money out of the stock market to try to chase that high return, because the stock market's not going to get you there. You have to start investing in a lot more exotic kinds of instruments, private equity, hedge funds, those sorts of things, to try to chase that return. And again, this is not just the PSPRS problem, it's not just an Arizona problem. Every pension system around the country is facing that kind of dynamic. And so if you want to know why those lines were crossing and not working together as you would sort of think they would, that's a big exclamation block. Now, I'm going to talk about just the problem for a moment more. You've already seen this. I want to highlight the last point. I've heard talk that the legislature hasn't done anything about this issue. And I think I see Senator Fan over here. She's been in the House and now Senate for years. I think she would probably challenge that notion. She's put her neck out there on the line. Representative Campbell has too. On many votes, not one vote last year, many votes since just the recession on pension reform. Unfortunately, some of the policy designs that were there on the table were challenged in the courts, and the courts basically have a pretty high bar in that pension protection clause that the mayor mentioned, that basically say, once you lock in a benefit, you're locked in, and no, you can't change it. And so there was a cascade of just rejected policy change after rejected policy change from the courts. Would that be accurate, Senator?
Yes.
So when my organization kind of got into this mix last year of trying to figure out, okay, we've got to troubleshoot this situation and start trying to get, you know, contain the spill, if you will, that was a big problem that we had to deal with, because, you know, a natural inclination of someone looking at this situation would be to say, well, let's just, you know, reduce benefits. Let's just do that. It doesn't work on legal grounds. You can't do that. And that's not just Arizona. It's many parts of the country where the interpretation of the law is that way. You make a promise to somebody upon employment, they take that on good faith. You can't just go back and yank that rug out from under them later, outside of maybe a bankruptcy situation or something like that, where there are explicit ways to break or violate contracts, if you will. So that's not, and the legislature's tried that. They tried that multiple times. It didn't work. So the liabilities are what they are. The debt is what it is, and you owe what you owe. And there's also, I would just say, a moral component of that, too. You know, people tend to think about this us versus them, or the employees versus, you know, taxpayers and all of that. And I would just say to all of you, I'll put it this way. I think the mortgage interest deduction on my house is ridiculous for tax purposes. I think it's a terrible tax policy. I mean, just from an economist standpoint, it makes no sense whatsoever. But I guarantee you, the federal government offers me that benefit, I take 100% of it every single year, because it would be economically ludicrous for me not to. It would just be irrational. Well, think, put yourself in the position of a young person, you know, going into police and fire. They sign up to a benefit, that they're promised, and you know, you sign up, this is the benefit you get, and this is what you can expect. And then someone comes away later and talks about taking that away. That, you know, I would say that's like not fair. So, we'll move forward. You saw this chart here. The mayor explained this very well, but you've got a mountain of debt that's, it's, you know, getting higher and higher. And meanwhile, the funded ratio is declining precipitously. They're just, you know, talking about the problems here. We talked about the investment, you saw the mayor's chart on the investment environment. The plan has been assuming somewhere between 7 to 8% returns for well over a decade, and have, on average, hit about 5. So that is creating a mountain of debt. And then you have this broken mechanism called a permanent benefit increase, and that's what was sort of fixed, if you will, in the Prop 124 last year. It was replacing that with a COLA. And what they were doing here, I mean, this was malpractice, if you will, terrible policy. They were saying, we're gonna say 9%. If you get returns above 9%, we're gonna take a big chunk of that off the top, and we're just gonna move it over here into a side fund, and we're gonna pay out benefits there. And they're not just one-time benefits. You pay that out and you add to that person's benefit for the rest of their life. You step them up. Yeah, that's why it's called a permanent benefit increase. However, that kind of siphon mechanism became a drain on the fund. Because what was happening is, well, with a pension system, you know, they have to ride through economic cycles and the ups and downs of the market. You have to be able to capture the upside of the good years to be able to have it there for the bad years, right? But what they were doing systematically was siphoning off the good years and taking that away, paying that out as benefit, increasing the liabilities, and then not having that there when you hit the two major downturns that we had. And then plus just the ongoing challenge of the interest rate environment, you know, and all those sorts of things. So, you know, when we looked at this, there are a couple of goals that we sort of walked into with this, and they're pretty straightforward. Retirement security for all employees. Retired, current workers, future. You have to think about retirement security. That's the point of the pension system. Beyond that, though, I mean, you have to balance that with reducing the taxpayer risk, their exposure to risk, that sort of thing. Also, reducing cost in the long run. Obviously, that's you're feeling that pressure here now. And then looking at stabilizing those contribution rates so you don't just have this upward trajectory, keeping that flattened out. And then making sure that you're actually creating a system that is going to work for the future, because folks coming into the workforce now, you talk about a pension or working somewhere for 20 years, they have no idea what you're talking about. You know, 20 years, I mean, you know, if you look at it, I think most millennials work something like 4, 5, 6 jobs before they're even 30. So it's a way different environment. So a benefit designed around a system where you're going to be locked in there for 20 years or plus, or 25 in this case, may not comport with the future. And then beyond that, improving governance and transparency of the system itself. You saw the return chart. I won't go through this here. I will just say that if you look at that kind of straight line that the mayor pointed out, that assumed return line, that's kind of the greenish one that's relatively flat. And then you look at the difference between that and the red line, that delta is a big reason why you have that mountain of debt, that big mountain of red debt, if you will, on the chart. So looking at what we did in the reform, there are a couple of key components here. And I could really geek out on this for a long time, so if anyone even want to talk about this after, we can go into more detail. And I'm sorry, these are small words up here. But I'll just summarize them very briefly. The first is we took that broken mechanism I talked about that was siphoning the good years off and paying that out as benefits. That's not the way this should work. The way most pension systems handle that kind of benefit adjustment is they have a COLA, a cost of living adjustment. They pay for it in advance, and they pre-fund it, and then you pay it out, and it sort of works. It doesn't break the system. Here, it wasn't working that way, so what we did was we basically said, you know, we think that replacing that permanent benefit increase mechanism with just a traditional pre-funded COLA tied to inflation and capped at 2%, and it's not just 2% of the national inflation, it's 2% of the inflation for the Arizona, Phoenix, Mesa metro area, which basically covers a big chunk of central and southern Arizona. We'll tie it to that. So we're basically tying benefit increases to the growth in our local economy. So the purchasing power locally is sort of keeps up with the purchasing or the, you know, inflation in your jurisdiction. So that's what that did. Then looking at, you know, capping the spill and moving forward. What we did to cap the spill and moving forward was looking at, all right, for new hires after July 1st of this year, they will now have a choice. They will walk into a system in which they can either choose to go into a a defined benefit pension system, but we sort of worked within, underneath it, to change some of the mechanics of it to make it more sustainable and a less expensive option than what was currently there today. Or if they're more of that millennial type that I suggested, might not necessarily think from the outset that they want to necessarily be in that job for 20, 25 years, they could choose more of what a traditional private sector kind of program would look like, which we call a defined contribution plan. One where you put in money, the employer puts in a set amount of money, and you choose some investment vehicles for it, and you're done. There's no unfunded liabilities. You put in your money once, and then you let the investment strategy take care of it. And so that's now what they're going to have for new workers moving forward. And we heard, you know, traditionally, you know, especially in police and fire, you know, around the country, you start talking about defined contribution plans and people freak out and they say, oh, it's not a pension, that's what we're used to. But it was interesting here because that's not what we heard. Well, I mean, we certainly heard folks that wanted that, I mean, so I don't want to diminish that. However, it was the labor groups that came and said, you know, what about a 100% defined contribution option? I mean, we were sort of already thinking about it, but they said that too because of A, they saw that the future workforce is different, but also they had people, for instance, coming in as police chiefs, maybe fire chiefs coming in from out of state, or maybe, you know, more seasoned, maybe have a pension somewhere else, didn't want to stick around for another 25 years to invest in a new pension system. And so having a benefit that kind of worked for them and made a more competitive environment was also something desirable. Beyond that, though, underneath that, we looked at the mechanics of this system, because I mentioned earlier that the public, employee side is capped in terms of their contribution rates. That means taxpayers are on the hook for all the rest. What we put in moving forward is full 50-50 cost share, skin in the game equally on each side, not only on the normal cost, meaning the prepaying the benefit, but if new unfunded liabilities accrue in the new system for this new tier of employees, the employees are on the hook for half of that too. So what it does is it creates a shared, you don't have as much skin in the game if you're capped and all the risk is on someone else. Once you equalize that and everybody's equally at risk, it changes the thinking, it changes your strategy of how you're gonna go about and look for benefits and things like that. It changes your thinking about how you're gonna manage this fund. And it puts you in a much more hawkish position on how this is operating. So those are the two biggest components. Looking at it, we put some other components, and I can talk about that later. They're not gonna be a huge piece for this discussion. But I'm wrapping up, I wanna give you what the reform did do and didn't do. And then just a couple of thoughts about Prescott particularly, and then I'll turn it over. You've heard this already, but what the reform did not do and could not do was reduce benefits for retirees and current workers. And also meaning, therefore, you cannot eliminate the city's unfunded liabilities. That just doesn't happen. You can't just wish away billions and billions of dollars of promises. What the reform did do is basically say, for every new hire coming in, you're gonna reduce the cost and you're gonna reduce your risk significantly moving forward. On the risk standpoint, we estimate it's at least 50% risk reduction because of that 50-50 cost sharing. Some of the other mechanisms, I would say, push that even higher. So reducing the financial risk to the city and thereby taxpayers. That's a key component of that. So basically, it doesn't matter for whether you're coming into police or fire, whether you're choosing the defined benefit option or the defined contribution plan, you're gonna save dollars on every single new employee after this tier goes into place in July. And you know, certainly the fastest way to, you know, as you start replacing those people, the faster you do that, the faster those normal cost savings are going to accrue. And then just by way of explaining the rate of return thing, right now, the system is assuming a 7.5% assumed rate of return. I will say, I don't have the magic number of what it should be. Where would I feel comfortable? I'd love to see it at 5. But if it was at 5, your costs would skyrocket. They would be magnitudes more than what you're paying today. Because there is a cost to making bad assumptions. And there's a cost to, wishing there's some unicorn out there that is gonna come and deliver sky-high market returns in an ultra-low interest rate environment. It's not happening. California Public Employees Retirement System, the biggest in the country, possibly the planet, and the California State Teacher System, second biggest one in the country in the last 2 months, have both dropped their assumed rate of return from 7.5 down to 7. Just for one of those systems, it was a $2 billion impact statewide to cities and counties and local governments and school districts, from state agencies, and their investment advisor would say, we think it should really be closer to 6. But they couldn't, I mean, just politically, they couldn't impose that kind of cost on a one-time, you know, change. To be more responsible means much more pain. So you're in this sort of catch-22 environment. And then just by way of saying, well, what's your chance of hitting that 7.5%? Now, the plan did reduce it now to 7.4 starting next year. Not enough. Good move, for sure. Not enough, but good move. But if you look, if you bury, you know, if you're really feeling like you can't get to sleep some night, go to the PSPRS website, download the recent actuarial report for the plan or for Prescott, pick one of them. It'll put you to sleep immediately, but if it doesn't, you'll get to some stuff like down the footnotes and these tiny language and it's really hard to read. You'll find probabilities of actually hitting your return. And you know what we can kind of estimate from that is you have less than a coin flip's toss of hitting that current assumption right now. So it's becoming more responsible, at least it's not 8, which ASRS, our other biggest state pension system, is still at 8%. But that, you know, there's a cost. So, I mean, these are political trade-offs. But having a 45%, look at that last line, 45% chance of hitting that assumed rate of return, that's not a chance I want to bank on. If you said, well, where would it be if we wanted it to be a 75% chance, your rate would be much closer to like 5%, 5 to 6%, something like that. And let me just say, defined benefit pension systems can work. One of the best one out there is in Wisconsin. But the way they built that from the very beginning is they have very low assumptions. I think it's somewhere in the 5% range still. And they have auto-correcting mechanisms within the plan that actually ratchet back benefits in the event of market downturns. But that's the way they built that system from the beginning. And so the expectation from the employee, everybody knows walking into it that the things are gonna move, benefits might move, but it's to keep the system solvent and to keep it there for everyone into the future. So we built in the new tier, we built some of those kinds of, we sort of lifted some of those ideas and built them into the new plan moving forward. But again, that plan moving forward is the cleanup of the oil spill. It's cleaning up a drop at a time. It's not, you know, going to wipe off a big piece of this at one chunk. And then, you know, certainly the 50-50 cost share, I already explained this, but it just means that now everybody's got skin in the game. And that means that even if the bad markets continue, your liability accrual and your risk exposure is still reduced significantly because of that 50-50 cost sharing and having that skin in the game. So I'll close with that. I just want to say, you know, part of the reasons why we looked at this reform, and you know, when you look at it, I'm not saying that it's the end all be all and that nothing else needs to happen. I'm just saying that, you know, when you look at that particular reform, we do this all across the country, and I've never been involved in a situation in which labor, particularly from public safety, is coming to the table with taxpayer groups, with legislators, to come up with a proactive solution, because the labor side saw the same thing we did. They saw a system in crisis, and they saw potential municipal bankruptcies out there. From the labor side, that's a bad thing for them, it's a bad thing for their members, it's a bad thing for their future prospects, it's a bad thing for hiring new police and fire, and you obviously know what the taxpayer risks are. So, you know, we think we made a significant stab at addressing some of that. And then from the taxpayer standpoint, you know, certainly looking at that volatility and moving that and reining that in, that equal cost sharing, making that an equal split between employers and employees, those are big things. And, you know, ultimately they will reduce the exposure of this system to risk. So with that, I'm happy to, I don't know if you want to wait for questions afterwards, Mayor, but happy to, you know, take questions when it's at the appropriate time, or happy to stick around afterwards and answering your questions too. So thank you for being here this morning. Thank you.
Turn the disco ball on, but kind of jazz up this presentation. Probably the greatest idea in the world. wanted to thank Glenn and the mayor for making my job a little easier, because they've already outlined what we're dealing with. And now I can talk about some of the things we're trying to do at a local level inside of our organization to address these. So, you know, I titled this Increasing the Efficiency and Effectiveness in Our Public Safety, and that's what we're going to try to do as a community. There we go. Again, the no dumb moment. Obviously, the PSPRS has posed a tremendous challenge to our budget, and the way I look at it is a pie. And what's happened is the slice of pie associated with public pensions is basically crowding out all the other people that need to get funded out of the general fund. And you're talking about a lot of services that people here enjoy. Things like parks and recreation, things like the library, some of the internal funds like our IT, the finance department. So what we need to do is explain to the public what's happening as that pie slice increases. And also what we're doing as an organization, specifically in public safety, to address these things. So the way I frame this, the structure of this brief presentation is what we're doing, what we're planning on doing soon, and what we're considering doing in the future. And I also broke it down based on police side and fire side. So let's start with the cops. And we'll start with cops. Cops, as many of you may know, is a citizens on patrol program. It's an auxiliary program that provides assistance with some of your ancillary law enforcement functions like traffic control, special event management, citizen outreach. And basically the idea is to have a team of folks like this who do these types of functions, and you don't have to use law enforcement officers who are PSPRS eligible. And this program's grown exponentially since its origins, I think, in 2008, to what it is now, which I think is 35 strong. Another thing that you're going to see that we're trying to do, back to the ancillary services or secondary services you see fire and police do, is find non-certified folks to do these types of things. And one of the things we've transitioned away from civil subpoenas being done by cops. Civil subpoenas are going to be done now by the Yavapai County Constable's Office. So that's a shift away from law enforcement folks doing these things to people that are not PSPRS eligible. And again, back to what I said, the overarching idea is to get away from having law enforcement people and certified firefighters in positions that don't need to be law enforcement or fire certified. Find ways to have them as part of the departments, but not eligible for this rich pension plan. One of the things that I think you're going to see that's going to dramatically change, I mean, it's almost a paradigm change in the way we do responses on both the law enforcement side and the fire side, is something that the council approved very recently, which is a CAD improvement, or computer-aided dispatch. It's a pending improvement. We've already bought the software, and we'll probably have it in place in the next few months. And the beauty of the software is it'll start changing the response from the minute the call is given. So in other words, when somebody calls 911, the dispatcher will have a template that they could triage the call and send the right response. So what does that mean? Well, what it should mean is we'll shift away from having too many fire trucks or too many ambulances at a scene, and gear the response specifically to who needs to be there. And that's just a better use of scarce resources. And that should be coming online, like I said, in the next few months. And then we're considering a number of things on the police side. One is, just like we did with the civil subpoenas, is to look at having other subpoenas issued and delivered by either private contractors or non-law enforcement personnel. Again, secondary services provided by folks that aren't law enforcement. Another thing that we've looked at is expanding the capacity and the jobs of our volunteer crew. The volunteer crew are doing specific things that I outlined a little earlier, but are there additional things they can do in the law enforcement arena to shift away from full-time law enforcement? I think the answer to that is yes as well. In fact, Mesa, the city of Mesa, has an interesting model where they actually have civilians doing accident investigations, where basically the post-accident event is investigated by a non-law enforcement person. And again, that shifts your resources away from PSPRS eligible folks to people that can still provide the service but aren't cops. And one thing that we're really committed to looking at, and the mayor has been diligent about talking about this, is the size of our fleet and the type of fleet we have in terms of our both law enforcement vehicles and our fire service vehicles. There's a party out of Phoenix that we've done a little research on. I think they're called the Mercury Associates. They come in and do an analysis of what you have, what you should have, where you have weaknesses in your apparatus, and where you have strengths. I think going forward, both on the law enforcement side and the fire side, we're looking at having those folks come up here and talk about what we could do different in terms of our capital purchases. And now if I shift to the folks that put the wet stuff on the red stuff, firefighters. The firefighters have already implemented a similar auxiliary corps. This was something that just happened this year. Their initial mission was to work on community outreach. Again, I think we need to broaden their mission and look at things other than community outreach they could be doing. But I think that having folks like this in your corps is really valuable. And it gets back to what I said again and again, finding secondary and ancillary services that can be done by non-firefighter and non-law enforcement personnel. Another thing we looked at doing was having our ARF station, which is the airport fire station, staffed by different folks, and we had an RFP drafted. We need to revisit that, we need to get back to that and talk some more about where that is. That kind of predated me, but we need to get that off the dime. And also, one thing that you might not realize on the fire inspection side, we have a certified firefighter that serves as the manager, but the day-to-day inspections are done by non-firefighter personnel. There could be a time at some point where even the management was done by non-certified personnel, but at this point, it's good for you to know, as the community, that we're not sending firefighters out there to do this. And again, I alluded to the dispatch on this side too, because it doesn't only impact the triaging of law enforcement calls, it also impacts the triage of firefighting calls. Things we're considering, one of the things I feel very strongly about is that we need to take, we need to take better advantage of our automatic aid partners and look at how we're actually doing emergency medical service provision. Are we sending the right people? Are the right people the ambulance provider, or are the right people the fire department? So we need to do a real analysis of that to make a determination of, are the people going to the call the right people to be on the scene? Second, plans examination. I don't know how many of you know this, but the fire plan is part of the building process, and currently we have a firefighter doing this. But there's some entities in Phoenix, again, that's all they do, they're private contractors to do this kind of service. We need to probably consider looking at having somebody or a group that's a private contractor look at these types of services. And again, we need to expand what the volunteers are doing on this side as well as the police side. They need to do more functions, because I think they're ready and eager folks that would be interested in doing things that are ancillary or secondary to actually, fighting a fire where we don't need a firefighter. Another thing, this is how I skipped ahead a little bit in my mind, we have the advantage of having multiple institutions of higher education, and there's some interesting models out there where you have professional firefighters who were there for just a period of time. They become professionals, but they don't become career, hence they don't become burdens on your pension system. Auburn, Alabama is a really good example of this. They have a program where they help students in terms of room and board, put them up in a fire station. They're firefighters for a 4 to 5 year period. I guess most kids are spending 5 years at undergrad now. So 5 year period of time, and then they leave, and then you rotate them in. And what that's like is the next bullet point, it's a military model. It's the idea of you have professional folks who are in a certain job category for a specific period of time, but then they rotate out, just like the military. I think it's something we need to look at here, not just with the folks in higher education, but just people in general. Are there people that would like to do this for a shorter period of time, not be part of the pension burden, but still provide a really high quality service? And again, one of the other overarching things we need to look at is how are we doing emergency medical transport? Not just transport, but basically dispatch, first response, and transport. It's one of the most costly things we do as an organization. It's also one of the most complicated to tweak with, but we need to be committed to looking at it because some of the problems we're facing. And basically in closing, what I would say to everyone is, if there's things you know about going on globally that we need to look at, we're open to hearing those. We need to be as creative as humanly possible to try to bring this project or this problem from an unmanageable point to a manageable point. And at this point, I guess we can all start taking questions.
Okay, we stayed pretty close to our time limit. Want to finish at 11 and allow time for questions. So if you come up, you can either ask a question of an individual or the three of us collectively, and we'll try and give you an answer.
Hello, I like what you, the manager, had to say about the fire department. I've heard that from the firefighters a lot, that they sometimes get sent out on calls that they really do not need to be there, waste a lot of time and money. That's not what I want to say. One question I have to ask is that after listening to everybody talk about the managing group for the PSPRS that manages the funds, are they the original people that?
Thank you. Part of the reform we did last year entirely reconstituted that board. Because the way that it was set up, we didn't think Match did a good job of matching the risk profile of the plan. And so there were a lot of, I'll be diplomatic about it, there were a lot of incentive problems. Part of, I mentioned earlier that part of the reform last year was going to a full 50-50 cost sharing model for all for this new tier starting on July 1st. We built the new board, meaning structurally, to mirror that. So you basically have, you have 50% of the risk in the system, you got 50-50 on the board too. So it means there's two, essentially two fire, two police folks that are appointed, four, employer slash taxpayer types, and then those eight come together and bring a ninth independent member.
Okay, well, so another question, you actually don't have anybody on there like somebody that does taxes, somebody that knows about stocks and bonds.
So,
because I know my husband, he had a, he had his account. He lost $500,000. It took him 3 years to get that back. But with his employer, he's really good. He should actually be on the committee. But with his employer, they never lost any money. They never got that money back if they lost anything. So the one thing I have a real heart, and it's not anything to do with the fire or police, because I have all of them in my family, but it's who you have on that board that's managing that money. It seems like even now, even with the new people, really still need to be looked at hard, because they need to have more knowledge of what stocks and areas would be best.
Right.
But I think that, you make a very good point. If I could just make two responses to that. Another thing that we required for the independent members is that they had to have either experiences in HR, actuaries, financial, we put professional qualifications to go with it. I think if I remember correctly, it was at least 10 years of experience in some, they can't just be Joe off the street making pension decisions. They have to now come in, and that board just got appointed, I think it was December. So that new management is now coming to shape. So I think you're going to see, I hope you're going to see the plan, the goal is to get, better decision-making out of it under the new board and the new structure, because the incentives were designed to sort of be more aligned that way. And then I will just say, though, don't underestimate the challenge that not only PSPRS, but every pension system in the country is going for. I mean, they're dealing with a very difficult investment environment. They all have good people making investments. However, the challenge that we're asking them to hit is an extremely difficult challenge. So it's not something where you just get somebody better to come in and try to hit a 7.5% return. You talk to people out there in the marketplace and say, how do you do that on a mass scale for a system like this? And, you know, it's not a very easy thing to do. When you look out there and you look at, you know, JP Morgan Chase or Citibank or some of those folks, they say, moving forward, the kind of portfolio that you used to see in a pension fund is not going to get you anywhere close to that in the market these days. So you then have to start rolling a lot of dice. It becomes like Las Vegas, you know, to a certain extent. So I fully understand, and you're right, you have to have good professional experience and people that know what they're doing. But that's not the problem. I mean, I would posit. The problem is we're asking them to hit an unbelievably high hurdle.
If we could have done that maybe a while ago, got some money on.
That's a fair point.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, you alluded to the city was considering selling off some excess property. For the last 20 years, I've been badgering the city to sell off excess property. I couldn't even get a list of what the excess property was. Excess to me means unnecessary. It's excess. It's not generating any tax revenue. Why don't we seriously look at getting rid of the excess property?
I'll go ahead and have the city manager speak to this, because I know he's been working on with the staff on that.
We are going to. It's not going to just be a promise, it's a commitment. We're going to bring a list to council next week of properties that we don't see any long-term or short-term benefit to owning, and we're going to list them and get them off the books. Thank you.
But I will say also that don't expect a huge amount of money from this that's actually going to make a difference. It'll help us make some of the payment, but it's not going to be a major increase.
Yeah, my question focuses more on an HR hiring practice, and I haven't seen anything up here that you presented that I'd like to ask about. First of all, traditionally, police departments, municipal police departments, and fire departments for many years have looked more when they had vacancies they had to fill toward hiring individuals laterally, as a lateral transfer from another organization, because there was a cost savings associated to that since they didn't have to put them through an academy and they could put them to work right away. With the advent of what we're experiencing now, not wanting to increase any liability, hiring lateral transfers, unless they are already in the PSPRS system from another organization, oftentimes will come up over as a tier one or a tier two employee, where you are going to have to assume that liability at some point on down the line. Is there going to be more of an emphasis on hiring new employees that are going to be under the tier three rather than going toward laterals? And if we do go toward laterals, is there going to be a cap that they can have no more than 5 years?
We haven't established a cap, but as an informal process to this point, we've erred on the side of new hires that are just off the street. Now, you need to balance that, because you don't want an entire force of rookie cops that are 20 years old. I agree with you in principle. It's just that as you make up a law enforcement department, you have to have a mix of ages and experience.
I understand.
I think that's a reasonable expectation for an organization. I do think going forward, especially after July 1st, when the tiering actually changes again, we're gonna always err on the side of looking at newer folks, but I'm not gonna promise you that we're just gonna have newer folks, because I think a department that's all 20-year-olds has its own issues.
Sure, thank you.
Hi, my name is Jeff Wolf. I came here today to find out what was going on with all of this stuff. And what I've heard so far is the taxpayer's liability. That's the main focus of the presentation today. But I haven't heard much about what the beneficiaries of all these pension funds are willing to give up. I was a trade unions member for 41 years, and we had collective bargaining agreements. And sometimes the membership had to give back to keep the funds solvent. And so it was a balance between the contractors' associations and the union membership. And it can't be an all one-sided thing all the time, where we're always on the hook. I hope that we don't come back here again next year with the same argument all over again, and that we could resolve this in some way, but we need to have participation from both sides of the problem. So that's how I see it. Thanks for your time.
Okay, as Charter City, we have, it's called Council on Defer.
Meet and defer.
Is, you know, we don't have unionized negotiations. But I will let Lynn go ahead and talk a little bit about the experience of working with the associations when you were going to move through with these kind of changes and how well that worked out.
Sure. You know, your point is very well taken. And if you look out there what's happening in the private sector on pensions, with the trade pensions and that sort of thing, there's some real issues out there that, you know, you have some going under, you have some, you know, that are, you have the federal system designed to keep them from going under, that's going under itself. So there are massive problems out there, and there's a whole body of federal law that governs what the private sector does on pensions. There, you had it in one of your slides, the ERISA law is something that says, that won't let private sector pensions get into the mess that the entire universe of public pension systems in this country are getting into right now. I seriously think that's something that needs to happen be looked at seriously from DC. But I will say, I mean, to your point about, you know, can you go back and sort of claw back, you know, benefits? Because that has happened in some jurisdictions, in others it hasn't. What I can tell you though is that in a situation like Arizona where you have a pension protection clause in your constitution, all it takes is you can have 99.99% of a union membership say, all right, yeah, we'll do it. We're gonna give you back 20%, something like that. I'm just making that up. All it takes is one to sue and throw the whole thing out of whack. And that's, you know, sort of the challenge in that kind of legal environment. You've guaranteed ironclad pension promises that supersede the contracts clause. I mean, you have promised in this state under law, not just this state, it's many others. So that puts, that's a bind. That's hard when you're making promises, you're not putting in enough to actually commit to, you know, that you can't pay, you can't afford, and then you lock yourself into that legally. That creates a really tight situation and difficult to get out. So your point's well taken. I appreciate it.
And I will say I've talked to some public safety people that have retired to this area from California, and they told me that, you know, to try and save pensions in their particular, I guess maybe towns or municipalities in California, that the union did come forward and give up some benefits. But so far, you know, I haven't seen any kind of movement like that here in Arizona
yet. And usually it's prospectively for like current workers, not retroactively.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Jim Lundy, Trend Research and Management, retired. Mayor, I want to really thank you for that presentation. It really outlined the problem, set some really good boundaries. Especially the first chart, I saw the elephant in the room, and I said, hey, a circus is in town. I thought the circus was in your office, but then I looked closer, I realized the real circus is down below. I'll get to the question, don't worry. I looked at your investment chart, and it showed that as the market goes down, you got your 5%. As the market went up and had tremendous returns, you got your 5%. I think the first lady was really knocking your investment manager, but that's symptomatic of a bond portfolio. It looks like a tent's on fire, and you've gone from about 100% down to 33%. That's a very steep wall to climb. If you're going to try and do some sort of a investment rescue, you're going to have to really honor equities a little bit more than bonds. That's what I see. My real question is concerns this defined benefit.
Defined contribution.
Defined benefit, you know, but the low interest yields now, when you have a payout, it's an explosive payout. It really undercuts you. However, when you make the transition, my question is, because I know this is everyone's hometown, I know you guys really care about your safety workers, are you going to base that amount you put into that 401k on the current amounts of money, or is it going to be post the sales tax where you bring the funds up, you know, because I can't run the numbers in my head. And I've seen this happen before. You know, there's the 50-50 contribution. That's true once the plan is set up. You know, they're providing their 50% of their retirement. But the question is, on the money that goes in, is that money based on the current funds, or will it be after a tax rescue or some sort of rescue to the total amount of funds? That's my question.
Thank you.
I'm not quite sure I'm following your last question, but maybe, let me explain a little bit about how that's set up. First, you mentioned something about the portfolio. I don't have the chart with me, but if you look at the way the asset allocation of PSPRS has sort of changed since 2000, even, you went from something that was, I don't want to say it was literally this, but it was akin to like a 60% equity, 40% bond, very traditional kind of portfolio that worked back in the 80s, 90s, you know, that worked fine. You fast forward that today, and this is the same dynamic we see literally across the country. What they've been forced to do is that bond or safe fixed income type of piece has reduced in size to now, I think it's close to about 10%. The rest of it, even just equities, like following that Dow chart, that's only probably about 30 or 40%. Everything else is that stuff that they have to, the exotic stuff that they're rolling the dice, having to try to chase these high turns through hedge funds, private equity, real estate, and they had some bad real estate investments.
I differ with you on exotic.
Well, I mean, just...
That's a very loaded term.
I don't mean, but maybe that you're point taken on, and I'll grant you.
And actually, I forgot my second question. My second question was, I really tapped into what that lady was saying. She's asking, are you guys actually have a board of people managing the Prescott PSPRS? Okay.
No, there is one board for the entire state. Prescott pays the same thing that everybody pays, and when you ask about a defined contribution rate, mm-hmm. that again is set in statute for everybody in the state.
Thank you.
Joe, good question.
Hi, Mayor.
Hey, how are you?
Mr. Gilroy, thank you for coming to Prescott this morning.
Thanks for
joining the town hall. Nice having you. My name is Richard Steelman. Oh, yes, no question for you.
Sure.
Is it true that Prop 124 included or added 6.6% Social Security to Tier 3 employees?
No.
No, it's not?
No.
Okay. That's all you need to tell me.
Oh, okay.
We're good there. Okay. One quick observation. This room right here is full of people that are on the hook, and the people that are on the other side, I don't see them. I just don't see them. I would expect this room to be full of police and firemen concerned about their pensions.
Yeah.
And I don't see them. They're gone.
They're here.
You got no words.
Get up here. Up there. Right here. Give us your thoughts. Get up here.
Are you ready?
Yep.
Go ahead. You know, first of all, I want to thank you and recognize the diligence that I think you and your folks have put in to try to find a solution here.
That's
and
right.
I know that this is took a long time for us to get here, and so there's no quick fix. Well, I'm retired on a fixed income, and I'm going to ask this question, which a lot of people may consider heresy, but I'd like to have an answer to it anyway. Do you know what kind of a tax increase and for how long it would take to dig ourselves out of this?
If that's bombing your question, I have to say, no, we don't. You know, the big problem that we have is, you know, until they start actually earning their returns, their expected return on their investment, you know, we still don't know what the current lawsuit is going to be doing for us. Parker case is still being adjudicated. So we're going to see additional liability. And, you know, sometime in the past, they had very accurate, inaccurate actuarials.
Mm-hmm.
I think now they have a better understanding of the actuarials going forward. So that'll help stabilize it to some extent. But basically, as I understand, as talking to our finance director, that with the actuarials, it's going to fluctuate. And right now we know that, you know, with the rate of return that they're getting, even if we paid off the system today, we were fully funded, we would have a liability next year.
I understand.
So
yeah.
that entire dynamic makes it very difficult for to say, you know, is it a half a cent, quarter cent, full cent, 1 1/4 cent, and how long? We just don't know. So that's what we're going to try and work through, and I'm sure we're going to have a lot of spirited discussion on it.
Yeah. Well, I understand that you have to know the impact of what you're considering before you can know what that answer to my question is. At some point, you've got to trust those assumptions, and I'll back you on it.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
My question is, with all the issues with the retirement system right now, why do we hire these new 11 new employees before July 1st?
There's several reasons. The first one has to do with the commitment that the organization made to these folks going back several months. Well, the other part of it is we were short in both fire and police, and the city council, and I'm going to speak for the six that decided that they wanted to proceed, thought that the risks associated with being short-staffed superseded the benefits associated with saving some money.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, and good morning. My name is Glenn, and thank you again for having this forum. Very informative. Last year, the expected return was 7.5. Do you know what the actual return was?
Yeah, it was 0.6. Which was also what California got. Like, I mean, the highest I saw was about 10%.
We're talking about country.
It was a bloodbath.
Thank you. So my question to you is, with the volatility in the erratic marketplace, and the fact that that the PSPRS board estimates 21 years to pay off this liability. I hear and read in the newspaper about others who say we want to raise a tax for 10 years. Is that real? Would we be able to pay it off in 10 years? And if we can't pay it off, isn't that going to be a prolonged tax? And how long would that tax go in order to do that?
Do you want me to? I think, Glenn, I think your point is very valid. I mean, when you were chasing an unfunded liability, it's going to be a moving target.
Exactly.
I mean, Len said it best very early on. There's so many actuarial assumptions on the back end that haven't even addressed. I mean, I think they used to think people's pensions needed to last 10 or 15 years. Now you have people living to 85 or 90 years old.
That's right.
All those things are going to impact paying it off. It's not a debt. It's an unfunded liability. The problem is the state doesn't give you the local flexibility to pick and choose what you do. And the crunch on this community and on our city is here. So the hope would be, would if you did something, you made something that's untenable and not manageable, manageable. If you're trying to set the bar to solve it,
right,
it's not gonna happen. So if you're trying to set the bar to, can we do enough that we can continue to have the community we have now? Yeah, maybe. I'm not being honest. And if that's not a bar that people can support, then we have an issue.
Yeah, I understand. I just want to make sure it's clear that 10 years is not really a real number. It's kind of out there.
Well, the 10 years, according to the finance director, handles the $78 million in unfunded liability in his mind today. And I have a lot of trust in him. He's really good at what he does. He's done it for a really long time. And he's really conservative about money. You can ask the police and fire about how they can pay. But because it's a moving target, 10 years from now, the liability might have really been 81 or 83. It could have been around the margins. But now you've handled the nut. You just have stuff around the margins to fix. That's the hope. And that's all we got.
Thanks, Mike.
Yeah. Let me add one thing to that. You mentioned something about the system. I just want to say this. I mean, what we're dealing with fundamentally is, I think you said, we're dealing with a system that was originally built when people didn't live that long. They didn't need that much to retire. And mortality has increased substantially because of wealth and the great things about living in the capitalist United States of America. However, we're living with an antiquated way of dealing with retirement. We're dealing with a system that was designed basically a century ago for a completely different context. The private sector sort of figured this out when they started seeing the writing on the wall, and moved away from it. Governments, with all due respect to the electeds in the room, governments aren't that nimble and, you know, efficient and move and change policy that quickly. So you're kind of in the retirement space nationally for public sector. We're kind of on the, you know, trying to steer this big mega cruise ship and turn it around in the middle of the ocean quickly, and it just doesn't work that fast. So what, you know, what groups like mine are out there trying to do is say, all right, there's a future out there where people are gonna go say, what were these guys thinking? You know, committing to promises, making promises they were not gonna live up to. That, and you have it in the hands of, again, with all due respect, electeds, politicians with very short-term time spans. And I'm not talking about the politicians in this room, I'm talking about the people who set it up, and, you know. And so you have bad, just the incentive problems are terrible. If you look at this as an economist, everywhere around this kind of system has really big incentive problems. That's why the whole private sector is basically, I mean, I think it's 85%+ of the private sector is shifted to a different kind of system, where you basically say, look, we as the employer are not gonna say we're gonna keep you, you know, funded in retirement. We can't do that. That's an impossible burden. That's your responsibility. There's gotta be, you know, that kind of recognition that, you know, the employees, you know, not just public, I mean, all employees in this country need to say, every individual who works needs to say, I can't just spend my dollars, say I've got to think about my retirement because I can't bank on someone else being there for me. So it's taking a long time in the government to turn that kind of thing around. I think the reform last year was sort of a recognition. I mean, you see now components going in there to have choices that, you know, start to move in that direction. And you know, and that's the way the public sector is going to go at some point in the future. It's just about how big does the problem get nationally. And just to put, I want to make sure you guys understand this problem in context. Nationally, right now, if you just believe the public pension plan's numbers in aggregate in this country, you've got about $1.4 or so trillion dollars of unfunded liabilities. That's under their assumption. If you actually use like realistic assumptions, it's closer to 5.5 trillion. The national debt in this country is what? It's like 19, 20 something, right? Mm-hmm. Put that into perspective. That is an enormous problem that we have exposed taxpayers to out there in terms of, you know, risky benefits. So, I mean, just the points on this, I understand the sentiment because we're in the midst of a transition to, you know, and a recognition that the way that we used to do things and the world that we thought was there isn't the world that we live in anymore.
And I will say that I talked to a public fund manager in Phoenix on Thursday, and he indicated to me, he said he didn't even think we could pay it off in 20 years, and that there could be such a dynamic in 20 years that, you know, it could be much more hazardous than what we have today. So all I'm saying is it's a moving target, and you know, I think if we say we're going to pay it off in 10 years, we're not being honest with the taxpayer.
And I appreciate your honesty.
My name is Kathleen Murphy. I'm an Arizona native and lived in Prescott for 48 years. I also ran the Big Brother Big Sister Agency for 39. I think you're supposed to say who you are. I have a son who is a captain in the fire department. That's disclosure. A couple of things I wanted to mention because I really try to listen to what you're saying. Number one, we had Mayor. I believe you said that you had two groups that you were helping you make these decisions: the Goldwater Institute and the Reason Fund, both of which are very good organizations. They're both libertarian organizations. I think we need a balance. And if we're going to have a discussion like this, I think your points are good. I think libertarians have good points. But I don't think we should be having a town hall with only one voice being available. Number two, I had a person who, back there, somebody said, why does the fire department need firefighters? I don't have one of these nice things up here, so you'll have to listen to what I'm gonna say. There has been a 64% increase in population in Prescott, Arizona, since 1991. There has not been one single additional fireman or firewoman hired, additional position added. We are down in the fire department by 6 firemen, I think, and that's with those 6 firemen in place. This isn't new information. I presented it to the council in the past. I unfortunately don't have that same information for the police department. So when people are wondering why we need to hire, we had a brownout. If you talk to firemen, that does affect your whether or not you're going to be safe. They have to be able to make those calls. So there is a reason. I'd also like to mention, I did give this to the council as well, there has been 186% increase since 1991 in the number of calls firemen have had to handle without any increase in the number of firefighters. So those are the statistics that were presented, given to me by the city. These aren't my statistics. And if I'm wrong, please do let me know. But I did present these already to the council.
Thank you. Yeah. Tim Andrew, I think you're looking at all those things that you developed while I was moving forward.
Must have.
Hi, my name is Helene Berman, and I'm just an ordinary citizen. And I appreciate what you're doing. And the only thing I want to say is take the library out of the equation for cutting anything. I hope I speak to the community, our library. We don't want to hear that anything more is happening with our library. We don't want to have fees. You know, we want to be like every other library in every other state. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Tom Haney. I'm a local firefighter. I applaud you for your information that you're rolling out, and you let the public know. We've known about this for over 5 years. I mean, this has been on our radar. We've had education that you would not believe on it. And everything that was brought to the firefighters, we agreed to. Cut it, add to our accounts, what we pay in, we're good with that. But we're not allowed to. It goes into court, it comes back, and then we're denied that ability. And I think you would probably agree with me that the firefighters have been the spearhead for years on this. I mean, we've pushed. Everything that you saw, the concessions up there, is what we brought to the table and more. So I just want the public to know that we're in the game, we're on your side, we're trying to provide the best service available, and we're willing to do anything to make it work. Thank you.
To that point, I just want to say, I mean, you're absolutely right. The professional firefighters of Arizona were the first group to really come to the table from the labor side and say to the legislature, guys, we see a problem, we want to be part of the solution. And that, I have to commend them for that, Brian Jeffries in particular, the president of the statewide group. I deal with this issue across the country. I have never seen a public sector labor union come to the table like that and say, guys, we're willing to put stuff on the table. And that has never happened that I've dealt with in many of these situations across the country. It's remarkable. When I go out and tell people in other states, you know, look what we did, not only with the firefighters, but it went to the extent that, like, some of those labor groups helped to fund, you know, the ballot measure to change this benefit. I mean, that, you know, that is an unheard of sort of thing. So I know these can be really passionate, controversial issues, and there's this tendency to say, it's us versus them, and I get it. Look, I get it. I know that feeling. I understand it. However, just remember that there are folks out there, you know, kind of that act in good faith on both sides of the equation. I'm a libertarian. People, the firefighters love it. I walk into the room, they go, you're a libertarian. We don't like you already. I mean, that's the way they started off. I remember we walked in and they're like, you're the libertarians. The police looked at us as fire, and they're like, we don't like you already. And we're like, we're skeptical too. It took dialogue, it took a year's worth of coming together and going, all right guys, well, how about this? No, why not? Okay, let's have it out. On every single point that you saw, well, I mean, I didn't show you every single point. I could go through 50 pages of legislation and show you how that came about. And that is, I think, an important thing to recognize here, that everybody came to the table in a good, you know, spirit of community service. So, good point.
Hi, my name's Will Potter. I just moved here. I'm a libertarian. I'm an ex-trucker. And I also have my red car as a wildland firefighter. So I'm just learning. I had, as a trucker, a lot of experience with what the Teamsters did with their pension funds and their exotic real estate investments, otherwise casinos. So please just tell me one thing. This board, do they sit and say, today we're going to invest in this property or this stock? Or does this board say, we're going to pick this investment advisor to handle the management of the funds?
I'm not there on a database. I'll just tell you my understanding is that it's sort of probably a bit of a blend of both, but I think it's primarily they have their own internal investment team and then some, I'm sure, advisors, because they're going out to get some of these other types of investments that their internal teams may not be used to deal.
That really scares me.
Really,
look at your chart, and that gets to the crux of a lot of this problem. You're putting a lot of faith in an organization that really hasn't done a tremendous job of managing your resources already. The problem is the impact local government can have on that is not as much as it should be. That's exactly right.
I'll tell you, the last thing you want are legislators.
That's exactly right.
And we've dealt with situations in other states where the legislature hamstrings them from investing in certain things, so it makes the problem even worse, if you can imagine that.
No, it's a huge, huge fiduciary responsibility, which seems to me is, it doesn't exist. So I think that's a super problem.
You're right.
Hi, I'm Dan Bauman. I'm the Prescott Chapter President of the Firefighters Association. And I appreciate everyone's work and attention on this. It's obviously a huge problem. And like Tom said, I did want to talk about a few things. We are very concerned about it. And we are here. Just something to keep in mind. We're very small, as it is. And we are here. There's officers here, firefighters here. We're 20% understaffed, and of that, 33% of us work every single day, and we only have 50 people to begin with, so, and we're here. It's just not many of us. And then to address some of the other issues as far as talking about how there's not work going on from both sides or concessions, there's, you know, there have been significant changes, and I know you can speak way extremely, you know, better than I can about it, but the elimination of the PBI across all of the tiers, I know there's a lot of confusion about that. A lot of people think that's only tier three. That's why it had to go to the ballot before the voters statewide. The change from a mandatory or 25-year retirement from initially 20, the average of the high five versus the previous of the high three. And can, hopefully you can elaborate on more of this. Then it's, these are all things that factor into the end benefit when we retire out of the system. There's also a minimum retirement age that is significantly, I don't even think there was there one before.
There's a, we call it the minimum benefit eligibility age. Sorry, it's a terribly wonky term. But what it means is, as of before this reform happened, you could retire whenever you want, and the latest year would have had been 25 years. But you couldn't start, so if you started at, say, 20 years old, or let's just say 21 years old, you start, you retire at 46, you wouldn't have been able to collect that pension until starting at 52 and a half. So the firefighters and any other labor group, I don't want to be just focused on the firefighters, but the labor groups agreed to bump that up a couple years up to 55, so that was one of the sort of...
And isn't there 62 and a half years minimum age in tier three? I think there's so many new...
To get the full benefit.
We're trying to wrap.
There's an earlier, we put in an earlier retirement option with a lower benefit so that you don't have to go all the way. And you, for less earlier.
Well, I don't want to hash out every single detail, but I just want everyone to know that there have been significant concessions made. The elimination of the drop program, which was initially implemented to retain seasoned and experienced personnel, has been eliminated. I've heard both sides of the spectrum on that. I, again, don't profess to be an expert on the system, but it. Some people say it has a neutral effect on the system. Some people said it had a negative effect. Either way, it's gone, and that's another benefit that's gone. And You know, I think those were kind of the highlights of it. My other question or comment, there was, as far as waiting to hire personnel for the new Tier 3 system to be implemented, I really question how much actual savings will come out of that, because there's the reason why we're 91% unfunded versus some of the Valley departments being a much lower percentage is the fact that they have grown and they've added more people to the system. And up here we have as many, if not more, people drawing out of the system than we do paying into it, and that's why there's such that disparity there. So I mean, there may be a savings with Tier 3, but I wonder about that without being an expert on the system.
Thank you. I mean, if you don't mind, I mean, yeah, so the savings on Tier 3 is generated by a couple of things. Put in a pensionable pay cap, which was really meant to not eliminate fully, but basically tamp down to the max degree possible what's called pension spiking, which is essentially if you don't have any cap on what your pension payout can be, or what piece of your salary is pensionable, you make whatever you want, but maybe not all of it is subject to a pension. That's what we put in a cap this year on that. And putting that into place helps to reduce that cost. Changing from the PDR to a COLA helps to, there are a couple of factors in there that reduce that. Now, I mean, I'm not saying it's gonna be huge numbers, but it's one of those things that for every single hire, it's a slight savings over built it to be, cost savings from a normal cost standpoint. Meaning again that, there's two parts of the equation, it's the cost to pre-fund the benefit. You still gotta deal with the unfunded liability payment,
yes.
And that is equal for everybody, no matter what tier.
Because
That still has to be paid off if you take it. So.
Absolutely. I just want to kind of clarify that
sure.
point. Anyway, it's not like by putting them in this system versus that system, it's a significant upfront. And I had heard people state that by doing that, you're guaranteeing them these 4% PBIs for the next, but that's absolutely not true because the PBI has gone away.
Right. Okay, so there are a couple of things there on that. The PBI has gone away for everybody. That's not coming back. Nobody's getting that anymore. Prop 124 got rid of that. And frankly, if I was the employee, I'll speak to you and all the employees. Thank goodness it's gone, because you're not going to get that benefit right now. You're not getting it. That fund has been drained. I remember I was telling you, that's the thing that was siphoning off the excess returns. Well, in this kind of environment, there have been no excess returns to siphon off. So that fund has been drained. And so there is no benefit that is being given out. So, I mean, it's broken for everybody. It wasn't just broken for taxpayers. It was broken for your members too, right?
We want it fixed.
And so a COLA is just a much more, it's capped, it's contained to inflation. If there's inflation, you get one, but it's capped. And so, there's that. I will say though, on the Tier 3 versus Tiers 2 and 1 thing, there is a substantive difference. And that's in the accrual of liabilities. Right now, in the Tiers 1 and 2, you have the employees that are paying a fixed rate and then everything else is on the taxpayer. So in terms of just contribution rates, it's very disparate and unbalanced. So, bringing in people into the older tiers means you're kind of bringing that risk profile in with them versus, the folks that are going to be hired later this year and in the future are coming in with the full 50-50 thing. They are not going to accrue liabilities at the same rate that folks in Tiers 1 and 2 will. So that's a substantive difference. And so I guess I would maybe push back a little bit on that point. There is a difference, and it's coming in terms of the potential for unfunded liability dollars, which is a direct cost impact. So it is different. It is very different.
Thank you for clarifying.
Absolutely, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'm Noel Campbell, I'm the state representative for the district. And I guess if I had any sense, I'd sit down and not ask questions. However, I want the firefighters and the police officers to know that I supported Prop 124. I voted for it, I worked for it. I was in agreement with the agreement that we reached, which that we would have a new tier 3, that would be substantially less burden to the taxpayers of this city and this state. And that was the agreement. Now my question to you, and I've asked it before, but Mr. City Manager, you never discussed the cost of the 11 hires to the city of Prescott.
Well, I think the 11 hires, the cost is variable based on whether they actually vest, which we don't know, right? We don't know how many of the 7 are actually gonna make it through the system to know how many years they vest with. I think that the finance director said if they do vest, the cost was about 125,000 employees. Is that about right, Mr. Mayor? So that's the answer to the question.
That answer is not what I understand it to be. Over the lifetime of these officers, if they go to retirement, the funded unfunded liability for them, for nine of them actually, will be in the millions of dollars. And so I don't think you're being honest in your discussion with the taxpayers to let them know that if we waited just 5 weeks, we waited just 5 weeks, we could bring these officers on, and that was the agreement that we made in Prop 124, we would release the burden to the taxpayer significantly. And the city council, and you all knew about this, way before we even voted down there after 124 came into effect. It's not like you did not know.
Well, Representative Campbell, I didn't know about anything in Arizona until I started October 10th.
And I didn't know, I'll tell you this, I didn't know anything about the firefighters that died, and I didn't vote on Prop 100. I didn't know any of that. But I did work 2 years on this issue down there with Mr. Gilroy. And I'm here to tell you that we could hire these 11 under temporary conditions. We could bring them on. It's not like they wouldn't get paid, but the liability to the taxpayer would be astronomically less. And that's my separation here. I support 124 and what it tried to do, but I do not support bringing 11 people on or nine on under the old Tier 2B PSPRS.
Okay. The time frame. Thank you. The time frame associated with bringing law enforcement officials on is not 5 weeks. There's two times a year you can do cop academies. We don't set the times. You'd have been delaying the hires for the better part of a year.
And I just want to make one other point. And this is another thing I'm going to get myself in a lot of hot water on. There's 253 officers throughout the state that are being brought on before the new Tier 3 goes into effect. 253. Think of the liability that adds to the pension debt when we couldn't wait. It's not that we're not going to hire them. It's just a matter of waiting. And you have the authority in the city council to rectify this. So I'm through. Thank you very much, sir. Okay, thank you.
My name is Phil Good. I'm the public policy chair for the Citizens Tax Committee here in Prescott. I'm a retiree. I'm a political and economic refugee from the People's Republic of California. And I think there's a lot of people in this room are in a similar situation. We came here because of this beautiful city, the great quality of life, and a very reasonable and much lower tax burden. Clearly, listening to PSPRS details, and I followed this issue for probably a decade. I worked with some of the state representatives and senators in California addressing these issues. And it's clear that this is a fundamentally flawed program. It's never going to get fixed the way it's designed. It's trying to decide how big of a band-aid you're going to put on a gaping wound in the emergency department and hoping that it's going to get better. It always seems that the first solution is how much are we going to tax people instead of fixing the problem. I've heard the word hope thrown out here, and it's clear in my 35 years of management, hope is not a strategy. We have to fix the problem. We're going to have to change the constitutional protection of this problem. I'm thrilled to hear that we have both beneficiaries and taxpayers in agreement. Why doesn't the legislature embrace this and take it on? Well, I'll tell you, it comes down to timing. If they think that each one of these cities and entities are going to tax themselves, they're not going to deal with this. We're dealing with this now because it's become a crisis. If we take the pressure off, the legislature is not going to deal with it either. Unfortunately, it's going to have to be a crisis for them too. So I think it's a timing issue. We should not address taxing at this time. We should keep the pressure on the legislatures, and we should allow our legislators, like Karen Fan and Noel Campbell, who have worked on getting it to this point, got this 124 enacted. David Stringer, I know, is going to support this kind of issue too. We can't offer a flawed solution to a flawed plan now. So I would recommend that the timing be different, and we also have to believe in the leadership in the city that's going to address this problem. I applaud the mayor for taking this forward and moving forward with it, working with the legislature. This was not an acute issue. It became known, and it should be aware of the leadership in our city, and should have started taking steps years ago to deal with this. Mm-hmm. I applaud Mr. Lamar for looking at some service delivery problems. It's great that he's doing this. This should have been done years ago. Yes, we haven't added some firefighters, but that may be a fact that we were a little overstaffed in the past. We're getting the job done. So my recommendation would be wait. Let the mayor and let our legislatures work on this issue. Get those other mayors who are in similar situations together. Apply the pressure of the legislature, and let's get this thing fundamentally fixed. Thank you. Yeah, thank you.
Just a short preface.
Are you going to repeat this?
Yeah. Whatever it takes to get the problem solved. Right?
I'm glad that you got it.
Just a short preface before I ask you my question. And the young firefighter got up here and asked you all these really good questions. He helped me come up with this question. But before I do that, there was a little bit of politics involved. And I'm an independent, so I'm very cautious of the latte liberals as much as I am the right wingers. And also the libertarians. Ron Paul's a libertarian. I read The Simpson Bowls a few years ago, and people should read it because it basically tells you what your government thinks about you in terms of balancing the federal huge deficit. And they're looking at your pension plans, and they're looking at your Social Security. So just a little background of libertarians. They're not necessarily looking.
Simpson Bowles aren't libertarians, I will say that.
Oh yeah, they were. They're silver spoons from Yale. Question. My question is for the firefighters and the police, not the people who are just coming on, but the people who have been working in the firefighting and the police for a number of years. When you create their 401k, their defined contribution, will you be using their net present liability for their year's service? Because what I've seen in the,
No, the defined contribution plan says, just like every probably many of you have from your employer, it says
401k.
Here it's a 401A, if they choose
401A. That,
which is basically a retirement plan, a defined contribution retirement plan built for government and nonprofit folks. It requires, all it says is you'll put X percent into, from the employer side, into your retirement account.
That's once the plan is set up. But what I'm asking you is for the tier, I think the tier three people and tier two, that's longer service. Will people with longer service, whatever they may be, will you be giving them the net present value in their 401k when you transfer from?
There's no transfer. No. That's not set up for older, their previous tiers. That's only for new workers. So they come in, they'll get employer contribution into a DC account.
So the older workers will keep their defined contribution.
That's correct. Benefit.
Thank you for this.
Just for terminology.
That is the $78 million nut that needs to be cracked.
Prescott City Councilman Steve Blair, thank you everybody for showing up, appreciate it. The council's got to make tough decisions here. My question is, this year coming up in our budget, which we're going to start here in the next week or so, the debt to PSPRS is how much?
On the fire side, is it 91% of salary? Is that what you're saying?
Well, total dollar amount.
The total dollar amount is $6.3 million.
Okay. So people sitting here that want to talk about where we pluck $6.3 million out of the general fund, that can't happen. If we do that, if we try to make that happen, we've already got rid of four upper management level people the last month since you coming in. We've got rid of almost 100 low level employees. We're short staffed with the fire, short staffed with the police.
when we look at through the general fund making decisions, where do we cut? And everybody wants to talk about don't touch my library. It got touched last year, closed one day on a Sunday. And I'm here to tell you, not the sky's falling, but if we don't find a way to infuse it with money somehow, that day of the library will be two, and then three, and then four, and the police will go down. We cut three last year, we cut four firemen last year. Every single year until we have an influx of money somewhere, we're gonna have 6 years from now, we're gonna have a library closed, no parks and recreation, the police and fire on its bare knees. And we wanna talk about what we're gonna do. We wanna talk about addressing the problem and how we should have done it a long time ago. We've been working on this since 2007. There's been several propositions that have been defeated by people saying, you don't need it, live within your means. I'm here to tell you, those means are gone. And I stand here saying that, knowing that the legislature, and you, Mr. Reason Foundation, that we should be asking our legislatures that are sitting in this very room, that took away our ability as a constitutional city that has a charter closest to the government to run our own city. They took away our opportunity to charge an impact fee on public safety. That means every house being built in any subdivision in this community does not pay their share for police and fire. That element's gone. We also got taken away from us the ability to charge for public safety on our water bill. We have the opportunity to pay for fire or for trash, sanitation, sewer, but the two very valuable things that we don't have the opportunity to put on our water bill, being a community that can make our own things happen, is to put a fee on our water bill to provide those services. If we had those two options, we would not be here today having this conversation. Thank you.
Okay, we'll take one more question.
And I guess I'm pretty lucky, huh? But I'm the only guy here, so. Under the tier three, you have the contributory plan. That money, is that money invested by the same board that's doing the fine line right now? Because I would think that if it's be statutory by the legislature, that that money could actually be put over to Fidelity or some other place that makes money. So the question is it being managed by the PSPRS board?
Yep. Unless you're going into the defined contribution option, then they will have a vendor like that, who you as an employee will choose what investment strategy you want.
Do they approve it?
No.
So no. It's going to be a
They'll approve the contract. But that's only for the defined contribution side.
Yeah, if you take the DB, it'll be still the same group of people.
Yeah, it'll be still in the same. I mean, it'll be the same folks investing, you know, for the pension side. So
for the
pension versus
for the 401k, let's call it that. So PSPRS is going to be in charge of investing them too.
No. What I'm saying, on the DC side, they're going to go hire a vendor, and then you will deal with that vendor, not PSPRS. The vendor will have a suite of options for you to choose from. You can say, I just want to go into a target date fund, and I'll say, I want to retire in 2055, and it'll automatically balance. Or you can say, I want to go into a high-risk equities thing, or I want to go conservative. But you choose that, and it's your strategy, and that risk is on you, and they're not going to backfill it if you make a bad decision.
But on a DB side, it's the same people making the investment, right. And you as the participant make the choice about which one to go in.
Okay, second question, tier one, tier two. Their COLA is a fixed 2%, am I correct? It's not a real COLA.
I'm sorry, sir.
We talked about in Prop 124, we went to a COLA, tier one and tier two still receive a PBI of 2%, not
just
2%.
It's up to 2% COLA, which is tied to inflation. So if there's no inflation, no COLA. If there is inflation, it'd be up to 2%.
So tier one and tier two, if there was no inflation, they get no COLA.
That's the way a COLA works. If it's capped to inflation, yeah.
Okay, because I heard that theirs was fixed.
Well, I can show you that. I can pull it up for you and show you that stuff in the statute.
Okay.
That's my recollection of it. If I'm wrong, I'll tell you, but I'm pretty sure that that's it. The only thing that's different with the new tier is that in addition to that, that COLA will ratchet down if the funded ratio for that tier falls below certain thresholds, with the intention of keeping that thing fully funded. So, and that's again, I was talking about places like Wisconsin that have functional defined benefit pension systems. They have auto-correcting mechanisms on COLAs and things like that. That's what we could build that into the new tier, but retroactively you couldn't do that piece. But you could do the just the switch without that.
Okay, appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, well, one more.
Okay, I'm Danny Lehrberg, and we moved here about 8 years ago. And I have lived in the state of Minnesota, the land of 10,000 taxes. And I want to know, just quickly, how do you fund, where does the money come from to pay for them? Is it sales tax? Where does the money come from, police and fire?
Comes from our general fund.
General.
Yeah, we have about $33 million
plus or minus, but Arizona is sales tax dependent. You know, Minnesota has property taxes that are significant. They have some municipalities probably even have state or city income tax.
We don't
have that. Arizona is a sales tax state.
And the legislature locked us into the current city sales tax rate. We couldn't raise it if we wanted to. I think there's a little small amount that they do allow to go up every year, but it's only like $30,000 for the entire city.
So, okay. Thank you.
Basically, we're sales tax.
You'll be happy here from a tax perspective.
Oh, I would pay more. I would personally pay more voluntarily on property tax. I mean, this is awesome.
And we would welcome the ability to be able to levy more property tax if we had local control over our own destiny.
I mean, if it was voluntary, you know, like, oh, it's one of the charities we give to.
Okay, thank you. Well, thank you everyone for coming today, and I hope we gave you some good information to work with. And we'll be talking on this much more in the future. I'm sure.